in part, it's, you know, they embody cultural values and social values. I mean, as Gilles Deleuze said, the machine is always at first social. And technology doesn't have agency, it's not autonomous. And the real locus of interest, particularly in relation to the things you're talking about, Nick, should be society first rather than technology. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'll just take one more question, guys. That's it. Lady at the front.
Sorry, as I say, they want coffee, they're getting a little bit upset.
Somewhere halfway through my mind blanked. That is actually which it was an ill-formed question, and in true Wittgensteinian mode, I suggest we just unanswer the question. because talking about sort of fact that technology doesn't have agency, I think is to actually make a mistake. But, that it depends on your point of view whether you assign the agency to the society or the technology, or indeed whether you can distinguish them. And again, it's back to the point I was making. I'm not sure there are some lines we should be wasting our time drawing. We have got here, we should put up the ladder, discard it, and work from this society, which is technologically determined in many ways, and not believe that we can sort of extract it in any way, but try to think as human beings and designers, the two are not only mutually exclusive, what the design principles are that will ensure that the technologies, the way we move forward, does actually encourage happiness and fulfillment. And as we've heard, happiness and fulfillment are not the same thing.
Doug?
I just wanted to ask Nick, you ended your talk by saying that you would encourage technological innovations that facilitated intimacy and depth as opposed to things like Facebook, which you see is not doing that. And I'm interested in that, and I just wondered if you had any specific ideas as to what were you thinking? Were you thinking of anything in specific there?
Well, I was thinking of those times when you lay in bed with your partner at 2 o'clock in the morning and you can just chat about the world and the phone's not going to go and it's just you and them. And that's what I mean, I suppose, by depth, because you asked a very good question. What do I mean by let's live life more deeply, because I think we're leaving an awful lot of breath or to death, and I think it hurts us at a profound level. So I'm thinking about those times, the times when you're just walking in the country for 8 hours with cheese and tomato sandwiches in your backpack with a best friend, and you're just talking, and that's what I mean by intimate. I'm not quite sure yet, so I haven't had the chance to think it through, quite how technology can facilitate that. Because I've only recently been asked, been invited to advise and discuss how technology might design and might move forward. So I'm very early in my thinking on quite how technology can promote what I describe as depth in our partnerships. Not a great answer, I'm sorry. It's a well-used technology in the service of that partnership. And technology is evil. We just misuse it.
Management of the company spent a lot of time trying to get work, so they didn't fall over a precipice in 3 months' time.
the rest of the company don't have time to come to sessions like this, but perhaps more important, they don't have time to develop innovative, creative ideas. Now, I used to work for big organisations like the BBC, and I can say quite definitely that the seven people I work with are a more creative and innovative bunch than any group I've ever worked with. But there simply is no opportunity. So I would have asked this question, I suppose, to Tom and David, but I'm going to ask it to Malcolm, is how can we find more opportunities in this general digital industry for those working in small companies to find a space to enjoy this philosophy and sociology and psychology, yes, but also to develop specific creative ideas for which there is simply no time and no room in the daily working life of people who are trying to survive in this quite understandably competitive industry.
If only we were webcasting the event and there was a Facebook group that we could all Twitter about.
I really have no answer to that, Martin, because I from exactly the same time pressures and time constraints as you do, and increasingly I find myself, I guess being a designer, I've never seen a distinction between, if you like, living and working. I remember somebody once asked Al Fletcher why he worked on weekends, and he said, no, why do I play on a Tuesday? And I guess, finding time.
Consequences of our reproductive success. So So you're not going to get anybody thinking about the problem until you reach the point where you have a sufficiently advanced industrial, intellectual, technical society that you can invent contraception.
So anyway, can we just slow that down just a tad? 10%. I'm going to summarise, gents, unless you feel... I actually think it's been a fantastic way to kick off the day. I agree with Nick in one way. We talked about forcing smoking back to the sea, which I thought was a beautiful analogy. And also Bill about how can we find what makes it good, what makes it bad, how do we do it? And anecdotally, again, doesn't make data, but I remember a quote from Richard Seymour, the product designer, who talked about calculators, again, about technology. He said, technology advanced and advanced and advanced, and calculators got smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, so they're on your wrist and you couldn't use them anymore. And then society just went, and it kind of bounced back to the right size. So now you can buy a calculator and they're this size, because that's useful. And I think the whole of technology in this argument has been, we don't know, Bill's here, death is here, I think we're going to get a very soon. So thank you very much. Quick round of applause. Something, Proboscis, Fiju, Igloo, Lulu.